Free and independent state.
Political coalition, the United Coalition, started here with a coalition with the Environmentalist Party from Pacific Grove and the Green Party, which was founded in Germany. And 20 years later, we have many candidates for office with the United Coalition, including 15 presidential candidates for President of the United States in 2016. And I wanted to introduce their names. Ernest Wells, communist from Tennessee, Roger Nichols, Unity from Missouri, Andy Caffrey, Democratic from California, Verone Thomas, Whig from California, Tony Jones, Republican from Rhode Island, James Lesage, humanitarian from California, Jonah Bolt, from North Carolina, one party. Tina Cook, also from North Carolina, independent. Vanessa Davis of Kentucky, the Defender of the Republic Party. Ralph Beach, independent from South Carolina. Rhett Smith, libertarian from Texas. Miss Joy Waymire, declined to state, from California. Keenan Dunham, Libertarian from South Carolina. Scott Olewine, Republican Green Energy from Puerto Rico. And myself, James Ogle, Republican from California. So thank you and welcome to the United Coalition. We are united within the USA and abroad. And thank you for joining us on July 4th. 2015 in Monterey, California.
Hi, James. I happen to be living right here in California and running for president under humanitarian. And, you know, it's kind of a great thing that you guys got started. Now, I understand that Roseanne Barr was instrumental in the creation of the all-party system. Am I correct?
Yes, she was one of our original founders. And she's written into our bylaws. She was the president of the all-party system company for 5 months.
Okay, so she found it in her heart at that time, which was a long time ago, that, you know, we don't have enough candidates and we don't have enough people representing the people. So and you've started this whole thing and you've been active with this plan to open up the democratic system of the voting, and which is so important that we all vote. And you are all about that, James. Now, you've got four chat rooms going. Why don't you tell us about that?
Oh, okay, yeah. A chat room with Facebook is where anybody can sign in and chat.
You can take it.
It's, we have the USA Parliament chat room and the International Parliament chat room on Facebook. And for some reason, the International Parliament has just taken off. More than 2,500 people signed in, 10 or 20 people a day.
Okay, let me interrupt right here. The International Parliament is kind of like maybe the United Nations, only that they're not pulling together and keep the wars. And you know, the International Parliament is where all the countries could come together and vote on things for the world. Is that the idea?
Yeah, it is a lot like, you know, the International United Nations. It was meant to be united. There are some differences. In the International Parliament, we elect 1,000 members from the world at large. You don't have to be from any country. We don't divide people. It's one large district as the Earth. And then those 1,000 members of the International Parliament elect the 10 executives who are subject to a vote of confidence 365 days a year. So that's different from the United Nations, the Security Council of five. They are permanently the executives from the five countries, USA, Russia, China, France, and Great Britain. And so that's how the International Parliament is different, because our 10 executives are from the floor, subject to a vote of confidence, and it's not five superpowers controlling, the decision-making executive body.
Okay, and now let's get back to the all-party system, and that you're running for president also. Am I correct?
Yeah, it's the USA. Fortunately, is president and vice president. It's a two-member district, and so we have an opportunity in the USA to run both president and vice president as a team elected by the people. And that's how the U.S. Parliament political entity works. Not like the U.S. election where the president picks the vice president, but by using the ranked choice voting system, where you must use consecutively ranked numbers beginning with the number one, we let the voters rank, and then the top vote getter is president, the top vote getter is vice president, and they might not be from the same party. And so that sets up a situation where the people who are trying to work together the best can often attract more votes.
Okay, so, all right, that was very informative. But what about, are you running for president?
Well, I'm categorized with the Republican Party, and, it's a lot of people ask, am I going to be on the ballot? And we're just trying to organize a united coalition, not just presidential candidates, but we also have candidates for county office, like Kerry Campbell, for supervisor of Fairfax County, Virginia, and Joe Phillips for supervisor of Dutchess County, New York State. And so our united coalition consists of all candidates who want to try to work together for the good of the whole rather than divide and polarize. So we do have presidential candidates, but realistically, we're the lower level candidates, like candidates for county and state office, have a better chance of getting on the ballot, of course.
Okay, James, I want to congratulate you for creating a forum for this open speech. Okay, freedom of speech. You wanted freedom of speech. He's exercising that for you. Okay, this through what he does in the all-party system. And the United Coalition, all the things that he's creating is a forum for you to give your opinions and stand up and say, hey, see me as the president too, because you know what, the president is just like us. He's an equal to us. We're the people. It's about us. So James, thanks for the forum.
Oh, thank you. And I just want to remind you, I can't take the credit. There's a lot more people working on this than just me, like James Lesage for president. And so it's a new team psychology, people working together, not any one person. Nobody is more important than the team.
Correct. I love that about what you're doing. It just opens it up for anyone. And for that, I thank you, sir.
Hey, thank you, too. Thank you for coming down.
Hello, America. This is the place to be. USA all the way. Happy 4th of July to all, no matter where you're from. Thank you.
again talking about Thomas Jefferson's letter and the idea that Americans should unite around this concept in the First Amendment, expressed in the First Amendment, that that the most important branch of our government, the most important political and the most powerful political branch of the government, the Congress, should not neither establish nor prohibit religion. So hopefully that makes sense, that if Congress, the most important and powerful political arm of the new government, cannot establish a religion or prohibit the free exercise of religion, then the rest of us should not be doing that either, as far as governance goes. You know, personally in your lives, of course you're going to have your faith tradition and beliefs, and that's a wonderful thing. And I think the framers of the American Revolution realized that. But in world affairs, we should not be condoning what I call theocracy, where the government, some foreign government and some religion are combined. And too often we see that in something called Sharia law. So I want to talk a little bit about Sharia law and the way my understanding of Sharia law, which is the culture that surrounds the Islamic societies, those countries and nations, societies around the world that are organized around the teachings of Muhammad and peace be upon the Prophet. But we need to remember that in America, when I'm not just talking about America, I think of America as the entire Western Hemisphere, but the United States of America, which is based on that concept, the American Revolution, the first freedom, the First Amendment, that we should uphold that in our world affairs. We should not turn around and then support a foreign policy and a military policy that somehow overlooks that freedom, that denies that freedom or condones a place or a people that establishes a theocracy, that crosses that line, that does not respect the separation of a religion from government. We undermine ourselves. And with a foreign policy like that, when we're sending our military support and supplies and our young men and women around the world, and then we're not leading with our beliefs of how is that improving mankind? What we're doing is supporting those that we're eventually going to undermine our own beliefs, our own values and culture. Because we're supporting a theocracy around the world that is antithetical, that is opposing our own first freedom. So we need to go in our foreign policy and look at all the nation states around the world and say, we will support those that believe in this crucial concept, this idea of first freedom, this separation of the government from religion. And we don't do that. Neither party of the Republican or Democrats, the two-party monopoly that we have in the United States, which I think it's crucial, is that, you know, we need leadership that's going to stand up for first freedom. And when these two parties don't, the Republican Party and the Democratic Party do not stand up for first freedom. Some people call them twiddly-dee, twiddly-dumb, because, you know, when it comes to foreign policy, they sometimes, the Democratic and Republican parties, you know, don't differ that much. And what I'm calling for is something completely different. So I would like to encourage all of our listeners today to learn about individual liberty, to learn about libertarianism. I advocate third parties and libertarian political party, and really learn about first freedom. And remember Amazing Grace, that we in this country need to learn again the idea that slavery was wrong, that we cannot allow slavery either in the 18th century, the 19th century, the 20th century, or in our century today, the 21st century. And when we, let me wrap this up, we only have a few seconds. And when we don't uphold those values for everyone, then we're undermining our own values. Thank you. And God bless the United States, God bless America, and God bless us all. Hopefully, we can learn amazing grace. Thank you.
This is James Ogle, Republican candidate for U.S. President, and we are here in Monterey at the USA and International Parliament Picnic and Convention. We have Mr. Abdu from Afghanistan. He would like to say hello.
Ma az Afghanistan astim. Aminje budbosh darim dar ayalat mutahide Amerika dar California Montreal dar shahr Montreal. Ma bishar khush astam aminje. Aminje zindagi ma khub ast. Tashakkur mikunim az mardamish bishar khub raviya mikunam ray ma dige bu jahaz. Ma spishan khush astim. Thank you.
And by the way, the president of the International Parliament, Abdul Shamali, independent, he is from Afghanistan. So we were very pleased that you could come here when we were right at this moment. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to refer to the Southern flag, okay? I'm going to talk about that because it's in the news. I want to hit on some current events. Let's just talk about it because Independence Day, some people think it's that we got our independence from Mexico. Some people are just really oblivious to what Independence Day stands for, where we came as a country and how we divided and had our own civil war and how there was a Southern flag and a Northern flag. And we try to represent together as a country. And still, there's people down there that just want to hang on to that flag and say, no, this is history. This is a good part of history. When, in fact, they were defending the right to have slaves. All right? Now, I'm sure there's no one walking on this planet that wants to become somebody else's slave. All right? And if there is, there's something wrong with them. All right. So anyway, it's not something humans want, and it's understandable. So let's just unite, okay? Can we finally unite as a country? And you know, if you like the looks of the flag, I understand, okay? But what it stands for was wrong. You had a bunch of people that owned a lot of land, and they thought they were so powerful that they could control the rest of us. All right, Abraham Lincoln died to be the guy that said, hey, we're all equal. I mean, some people have sacrificed everything for where we are today. And as a country, as a world people on the planet, your humanitarian president, that would be me if voted in, would make sure that no one is ever treated badly on the planet, okay? There would be places for people to seek refuge, places for them where they would be helped and taught trades, and everyone would learn to take care of the ones that can't take care of themselves, because that's who we are as a race. You know, all you got to do is look at what's below your feet, and you see in nature how the colonies stick together. All these ants that are they're fending for themselves. I know there's a territorial kind of thing going on, but all the demonstrations are below your feet, okay? And all of them can learn to get along. And now when you become so smart that you can provide for all colonies everywhere, gee, wouldn't you want to do that? I mean, we're all the same. And there's plenty of room. Please don't tell me that we're overcrowded and there's no more room for human beings on this planet. That's ridiculous. Get in an airplane and go somewhere and look down, all right? And the man is so smart, we're going to live on the ocean if we want to, in the ocean if we want, under the ocean. We'll live in space if we want to. We are that smart. There could be air homes floating around, okay? Neoteric, it means that we're always going forward, always learning, always progressing into the future, and that's what we need to be as a race, okay? Not just to let some of the race of the human beings just fall off like they're not, like they're nothing, okay? That's not who we are. We can, if you find a little dog on the street that knows nothing, he's just fending for himself, he knows nothing of you and your ways, pretty soon, if you make his life better, he loves you and he's loyal to you. That's just like humans. If we're all good to each other, we'll be loyal to each other. All right, and that's the end of my speech. Let's live together. Let's unite this country. Put down all those stupid ideas of not being together with your neighbor. I think differently than him. My religion is different. He wears different clothes. He looks different. Come on, get past all that. Let's graduate out of the, let's get out of the playpen and become adults. Thank you. Thank you. Vote for me.
As we remember all those who have served our nation, I remember my own father who is buried in Fort Sam Houston National Cemetery. A first freedom of America is that every religion will be respected and the free exercise thereof. I now challenge the Federal Communications Commission and all broadcasters to do exactly that and to air our campaign for religious rights in America, to challenge directly Zionism and the Restoration Project movement. With these few words, I humbly announce my campaign for the office of President of the United States of America.
My name is James Ogle. I'm currently registered with the Republican Party, running for President of the United States. And the reason why I'm running is I want to help not just the Republican Party, but all parties to learn about a new ultra-conservative voting system that doesn't just liberally throw away and waste votes. It's called pure proportional representation. And simply by using ranked choice voting in multi-winner districts, which is consecutively ranked numbers beginning with the number one, we can create a tool that brings inclusion into government and unity. People working together, the Libertarian, the Green, the Republican, the Democratic, as well as independent, nonpartisan, and declined to state. By electing larger teams working together with many multiples of alternatives for either names or decisions, we have a peaceful decision-making alternative to force and violence. Our country should be helping other people in other countries learn by setting an example, by using this voting system as an alternative to civil war, to division or polarization. But we need to work together on this in 2016. So I would like all of you Republican candidates and voters, as well as the Democratic Party candidates and voters, Green Party, Libertarian, Peace and Freedom, American Independent, Constitution, make up your own party. we can do this, but it's going to take work to get this system, the USA Parliament's all-party system, implemented within each political party so that we can join together instead of being separate and divided. Then we can have more ideas for solutions for the whole instead of only a small portion. The more ideas, the better. And that's what we want to do, is help facilitate more and more names, more and more ideas for solutions for the good of the USA, and even to help people who are not as advantaged as us, having a democracy that's 250 years old, people from all countries to be able to learn how to find solutions within their own countries, or even the world at large. So join us, join James Ogle for president with the Republican Party, and let's try to make these changes for the good of the whole. I don't have to be president. I could be vice president on a woman's ticket, or vice versa. We need more women in government. And fortunately, president and vice president is as a two-member district. It gives us a chance for that gender balance, so that we can consider voting for the top-ranked female and the top-ranked male, or vice versa, however the voters put as their number one choice. That's what we want to do in 2016. Thank you very much.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed his faithful lightning up his tail.
Happy 4th of July, patriots out there, beware that they're out for us on this go-round, so be careful on your activities that you do on this holiday weekend. And that being said, I want to talk about the amendments, especially the Second Amendment, which is really the one that allows us to maintain all the rest of them. Without the Second Amendment to back the First Amendment to give us the freedom to do all the rest of it, we're sunk in the water. You'll be like Northern Vietnam. You'll be like North Korea, Iran, all these countries that you don't have freedom of speech in, and you can't be out there and be proud of what you're doing and what you're saying. You know, First Amendment gives the people that are in favor of flying that Confederate flag the right to say what they have to say about the Confederate flag. And it also gives us the right to say, if you're against the Confederate flag, be able to say that. And that's what's so great about this country. Where it falls short is that one side wants to think that just because they have the right to say something, that's how it's supposed to be. And unfortunately, it's the laws that dictate what is allowed and what isn't allowed. So when people go up and pull flags off of flagpoles, if the laws allow that flag to be there, whether I like it or not, I gotta respect that. So take care and learn your laws, learn who's governing those laws. If you don't like them, go through the right measures to get them changed. And have a great 4th of July, and be prepared for everything that's coming, because change is here and we are going through it. So let's see and take care to make sure that those changes are favorable for everybody.
And by the authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare
that these United Colonies are, and of right ought to be, free and independent states.